So they've stopped everything here.
So traffic has stopped.
And now we're down to about 5 miles an hour. We're not moving very fast on this vehicle. What happens when the tires go flat? Well, you've got to rev the engine harder, it overheats, or the rims, the tires come off the rims, and the rims heat up and lock up the brakes. So it's just a waiting game. With 12 police vehicles back there, plus three or four ahead of him, he's not going anywhere. He's, you know, just biding his time.
And it looks like the window is down, right? The driver's side window is down. It's hard to tell if, I'm assuming it's a gentleman from what I can see, if he was waving something out of the window. What can you see from your vantage point?
Well, it looked like he was just waving or saying something to that individual that was talking to him. I'm gonna drop in an extender here and see if we can get a little tighter. It's gonna go to dark a little bit, and then I'll be right back. There we go.
There we go.
You can see better there. Yeah.
Yeah. That helped.
So you can see that the driver of this vehicle wearing a light-colored shirt of some kind.
It looks like a collared shirt, long sleeve, yep.
Now we're picking up a little bit more speed here.
Yeah, it does look like he picked up speed. Definitely faster than 5 miles per hour.
But if he's on four flat tires, that could actually end up exacerbating his situation and causing more damage to the car, could it not, Vinny?
Exactly. But what happens is you'll ruin the, of course the tires are ruined already,
right.
But they'll come off the rims, and then you'll be running steel on asphalt or steel on concrete, and that will generate a lot of friction, a lot of heat, which then in turn it boils off the grease in the bearings, and the bearings lock up, and then nothing moves.
What are you seeing up ahead? Can you widen out for a moment just to get an idea? Okay. Plenty of
PCH
space
is totally cleared all the way up the coast here.
Wow, okay, completely cleared. Just this car on the road and the police cruisers falling behind.
And again, there's a reason why law enforcement officers at this point are playing the waiting game. Because if there's someone in that vehicle who actually is armed, and there have been reports of that, well, this makes the situation that much more dangerous.
You're exactly right, Tony. Again, as I said before, it's just a waiting game now. The law enforcement entourage behind this vehicle, they're just going to wait till it stops. They can't do much other than that and not jeopardize other people on the ground here.
And it's going to stop one way or another. Either it's going to stop because everything's going to lock up, or it's going to run out of gas.
I don't know, Vinny, if you're catching this, but it almost, okay, I see him taking a sip of something, but I almost saw him blowing some smoke out for a moment ago, or just drinking, took some pills.
It could be, yeah, it looked like he either took some pills or
he's gesturing. Did you see that? He's gesturing as if he's talking to someone on the phone, or he's just frustrated.
There's someone next to him, right?
And he may be talking to the passenger next to him.
Yeah, there's somebody in the seat next to him, so they're having a conversation in there. Be real interesting to be a fly inside there and see what they're talking about.
Okay, he's gesturing to police, too, it seems.
Right.
Yes.
Looks
like he was gesturing at the police that were standing outside the... Okay, my pilot just pointed out that there are people on the bike path that are following along.
Vinny, let's continue to follow this, and we're going to bring in Dennis Zine, a former councilman and who also has associations with law enforcement as well. Dennis, what are we watching? What is the procedure here? This obviously could be a very dangerous situation. Good morning.
Good morning. Well, the danger is if he has a weapon. There's obviously two people in the car we can see from the shots from the helicopter, but the fact is, and it's interesting, he was coming up here on the left, where they're breaking intersections to slow and stop traffic at the intersection that he's crossing, but it's highly bizarre. He's got the tires that are out. You got bicycle riders now that are approaching on the left. It's become a comedy scene, which oftentimes it does. In this particular case, I saw him drinking some kind of a liquid out of some bottle or a can.
Yeah.
He's just casually driving down the road, not a care in the world. And he's obviously not yielding to the officers who are following and those that are then moving ahead and blocking traffic at the intersection that he's going to cross. So this is one of the bizarre pursuits from the city and the county and the state of California. Well, it's highly bizarre what's happening with him right now.
Well, his demeanor.
You see the gestures.
Yes, his demeanor is just so nonchalant.
It's very, very bizarre behavior. And he's sitting there having, obviously, a passenger, whatever conversation they're engaged in, and he doesn't have a care in the world. He's obviously not speeding. I don't know how he can with the situation with the tires, but you've got an army of officers, the vehicles. Now you have another police vehicle that's going to be passing on the left. What they're doing is going up to the intersections to block traffic to make sure that no innocent party gets involved in this. So this will go continuously. They're not going to do a pit maneuver, at least it doesn't look like. And this is a perfect area where the speed is slow enough and you don't have any opposing traffic. You don't have any parked vehicles. But if he does have a weapon, that's the hazard. If he has a weapon, they have to use extreme caution because if they do a pit maneuver and there's a weapon involved, the officers don't want to jeopardize themselves or anyone nearby.
So exactly. And Dennis, when you have two people in this vehicle, one is bad enough. But I would think that if you have a second person, that just escalates things all that much more exponentially, I would imagine.
Well, it's uncertain. You don't know if that other person has a weapon. You don't know if the other person's been kidnapped. There's no idea. You see the intersection blocked down. All the police cars that are there blocking the intersection, and he'll pass to this intersection. Then they'll move ahead. He's not speeding, obviously. He's not yielding. He's just like a parade. It's just like a parade going down the roadway. And the intersections are blocked off by all the units. And as soon as he passes, just like they do a motorcade, if they do a motorcade for head of state, they block the intersections. Now, normally on motorcycles, I don't see any motor officers out there, just officers in cars. And then the helicopter's overhead, and he's just casually going down the roadway. Everybody's watching. He's passed through it safely, and now you'll see the police cars move ahead of him, and they'll be leapfrogging. And this will continue until he wants to stop or some other action is taken. But if he does have a weapon, and there's some concern about that, they're not going to do anything to endanger themselves or any of the public. So this could go on for a long period of time based upon the amount of gas he has in that vehicle.
Well, and Dennis, we're now getting some additional information from law enforcement about this particular situation. And what we're finding out is that this person, the driver, is in the car with his girlfriend. She's in the car with him, and that they're speaking to a third party.
His sister
on the phone.
Okay.
And by the way, his girlfriend is there with him willingly. This is not a hostage situation.
So this is coming to us from the police, so we can confirm that. The suspect in the car, along with his girlfriend, who's there willingly, and they're on the phone with the suspect's sister at this time.
And he doesn't want to stop for whatever reason. He doesn't want to yield to the police.
Well, at this point, he has, all this distance that he can go. They've cleared the road for him, basically shut down the street. But at what point will police intervene? I understand they're a bit hesitant because of the reports that he's armed and dangerous. But is there at any point that he'll intervene when he starts to interfere with other drivers and traffic?
Well, if it wasn't for the fact that there was a fear of a weapon, they would have already done a pit maneuver. They had an ideal situation to a pit maneuver way back when. He'll get charged with evading. He's not going to be charged with reckless driving because he's not driving in a reckless fashion, but he is evading. So ultimately, he'll be going to jail. I don't know what's going to happen with his girlfriend in the car.
And going back to jail, apparently, Dennis, because we're receiving information that he may have just been released from jail.
Well, then obviously, he's been through the system before. And he's just carrying on having his little parade and his status on local television here in Los Angeles. This is obviously slow. He's probably going less than 30 miles an hour. And those tires, how many of them are out, he's still maneuvering down the road. You don't see any sparks flying. You don't see any fire ignited, which oftentimes will happen when the tires give out and you're riding on the rim. You'll see sparks and the fire could ignite.
Yeah.
But you have a whole parade of police cars behind this individual. The speed isn't increasing, it's not decreasing. Now you'll see another police vehicle coming up on the left. It'll take another intersection. So this is basically like a parade or an escort detail for a dignitary. That's exactly the way they deploy, and they take the intersections, except on motorcycles.
And we understand, actually, at least the reports we're getting, we haven't confirmed any of this, that three of the four tires have been blown out.
Mm-hmm.
And it's interesting that he's not sparking, that the wheels aren't sparking because you're running.
Well, it seems like he's going slow. That's
Well, he is going slow, but the fact is you're rubbing on metal now.
Yeah.
And that metal with the asphalt should be sparking, but maybe he's going slow enough where it's not happening.
Mm-hmm. Now,
eventually, he'll run those rims down to the bare metal. There'll be nothing to run on.
Have you noticed when we were doing part of this pursuit, covering part of this pursuit, the driver's side window was down. Those windows are very
tinted.
Darkly tinted. Now
yes.
The window is up, which, again, that kind of increases the danger in all of this.
Well, it does. There's no question. It's a danger to the public, danger to the officers, and the officers fear if there is a weapon, and there was conversation of a possible weapon, they're going to err on the side of caution. They're going to be cautious for themselves, for the individual, as well as the public. So caution is going to be extreme. But in this particular situation, they have enough units there to take him down, to take him into custody, to bring this to an end. But with that fear of a weapon, they're going to continue following. They're not going to do a pit maneuver because you have ideal situation here, a wide roadway. The speed is appropriate to do a pit maneuver. But as you see, he's passing now through additional intersections. Officers are there deployed as they would for a parade or for a dignitary protection detail. So this could go on literally for hours until he decides to stop or that car finally gives out through lack of gas, which seldom do we see in these pursuits where they run out of gas. I don't know why it is, but seldom they ever run out of gas.
Why do they have a full tank when they start these things?
I know.
They always do.
It does seem that way, doesn't it?
Well, going slow speed, you're not going to burn much gas anyway because you're not burning gas at the same rate if you're speeding. So he's burning little fuel and just casually going. He's probably not going more than 30 miles an hour, if that. And as you see, this is what considered a very slow speed pursuit. But you probably have multiple agencies there. And they're just going to continue on this until he decides to stop or something comes into play that will take him to the curb where he will stop. But I don't see that happening with the current situation. And what time did this start?
So this started, well, let's see. Would you say like 40 minutes ago, Tony? It seems like right around there. It started at Bun and Grove. And, you know, we ended up in Westminster when we picked it up. We picked up our coverage with Vinnie Mac up in Sky Fox. So for those of you who are just joining us, a suspect with his girlfriend in that vehicle, girlfriend is in the car willingly, we're told by police. They were earlier, perhaps they still are, on the phone with a suspect's girlfriend.
Suspect's sister, excuse me. Yeah.
The girlfriend is sitting next to him. And we're told that he had just been released from jail, and apparently this is a stolen car.
Three of the four tires, we've been told, have been flattened, so he's either on the rims or will soon be on the rims at this point. And Dennis Zine, who is a former city councilman and former LAPD, is with us, and he's sort of doing a play-by-play, if you will, of what's going on here. We have been told that perhaps there is a weapon in the car. We don't know that for sure, but apparently, at least by some reports, a gun had been spotted. And Dennis Zine, I've often heard, and you are former LAPD, so you can confirm or debunk this, but I've often heard that law enforcement is particularly concerned about any pursuit, but especially any pursuit that lasts longer than 60 seconds, because the longer things go, the more anxious and perhaps the more escalation you get with these things. Is that true?
Well, there's adrenaline when the pursuit begins. There's a lot of adrenaline, and then as it continues, the adrenaline starts to dissipate, start getting more control, getting more units. This now, at this speed, there's probably not much adrenaline from the officers that are pursuing. It's not a high-speed pursuit, but initially when you get in a pursuit, that adrenaline's pumping, and you want to watch that individual, you want to watch the other traffic, you want to watch for pedestrians, you want to make sure that no innocent person is involved, and you want to apprehend that individual who's fleeing in a safe manner. So what you see in this particular situation, going on almost an hour, those officers are very calm. The demeanor is appropriate, and they're just going to follow this until he decides to stop or the car gives out. But if he just got released from jail, he knows the system, and he's gone through it before. And whoever owns that car, obviously they don't want to see that car damaged because that's their pride and joy. So how he got in that car, how he got the girlfriend in the car, and how this whole thing began is going to be questioned through the investigation. But one way or another, he's going to be going to jail. She may be going to jail along with him if she's a willing participant and not stopping if they've committed some crime prior to this situation where the pursuit began. But as you see, there's a whole army of units behind as we continue down the roadway, and there's no parked traffic, there's no pedestrians. again, this is a ideal situation for spike strips, but obviously they've deployed those. That hasn't stopped them. Pit maneuver, that would be ideal location with the speed, with the conditions. But again, you've got that concern of a weapon. So the officers are very calm, but the first 60 seconds, that tells the pitcher, is it going to be a high speed? Is it going to be a low speed? What are the other factors? Are there children
Dennis,
in the car?
Dennis, it looks like he's slowing down there.
Yes, yes, he is. And you've got some good camera view. The people in that helicopter are doing a great job with the camera view. If you'd open his sunroof, we'd have a good view of him inside that car.
And
but
it
the
looks
windows
like
are up.
It has stopped. Are
up. Now he's stopping. Now
right.
he's stopping.
Now the question is he going to stay stopped?
Well, does he have a choice? The car might not go any further.
Well, unless it's run out of gas, because he's been running on those rims, on the three rims.
Right.
He's got that one tire. So now we've got the stop. So they're going to hold back.
The window's
they're
down.
Not going to approach.
He's hanging
out
of the window.
Now it's a critical time. Now we have the adrenaline pumping again. They're going to approach. They're not going to get too close unless he takes off again or he jumps out and runs. If he runs, he'll have a number of units, probably K-9 chasing him.
And here's the thing, Dennis. Usually in this situation, what you would advise is that he just listen to the police officers and follow their commands. Is that not right?
Well, they would be ordering commands right now.
And
he's
talking
back. Conversation. Yeah.
He's having a conversation with him.
He seems very animated.
They'll order him out of the car, and obviously he's having a conversation, but he's not complying exiting the vehicle. So it looks like he's arguing with them by his gestures.
Yeah.
At least his hands are out.
Well, his hands are out, but we don't know about the girlfriend, if in fact there's still a weapon in the car. And if there's no weapon in the car, this could have been taken down a lot earlier. That's what really puts the kink in this. And the fact is, if there is in fact a weapon, and they're going to err on the side of caution,
sure,
and reasonableness, and they're not going to take the chance of getting hurt or hurt an individual who could even be the girlfriend. So if it turns out there's no weapon in the car, just a slow speed pursuit of a stolen car, he'll go to jail, the car will be impounded. But you have an army of officers that are being pulled for this detail away from their normal assignments, and the people who need police service in that particular area are probably going to have a delay just because you've got so many units tied up in this.
Well,
but you've got officers out there.
It's a waste of resources. They shouldn't have to deploy this many people.
The officers have their weapons. They've got their
They have their weapons drawn.
They're either shotguns or AR-15s.
Right.
They're not using the sidearms. So there's a concern that he may have a weapon. You wouldn't see them with those weapons unless that was the case. But they're taking a place of cover. This conversation, how long is this going to go on, or is he going to take off again? But it's just a wait and see at this particular stage. Once the officers are barking orders, they're probably using the megaphone on the police vehicle, ordering him out, telling him what to do.
So we're seeing a number of units behind the car. What are there any in front of this car? Can we widen out and take a look?
Okay. I think there are probably some that were
way
out there.
Way ahead, yeah.
Yeah, you know, breaking intersections, holding up the intersections. So as it stands now, everything's going to be status. They're going to block traffic on that roadway, whatever roadway this is, north and south, east or west. So everything's going to come to a standstill until he decides to get out of that car and is taken into custody. Once he's taken into custody, now we see a nice view. It's a desolate area. This is a perfect area to take someone into custody.
Yeah, I was about to say, at least there aren't people around to perhaps be hurt by this other than the officers who, needless to say, are also putting their lives on the line here.
The
door's opening, the
passenger
side door
is opening, and he's still hanging out of the driver's side.
So now if the passenger gets out, now the window, when he's back
looks
in,
like
the window's open.
She's coming out.
And she's
so
she's
have,
complying. She's
there
complying.
We go.
Hands up, walking
but
backwards.
He's got one arm out. He's got one arm in the car. So now she looks like she's exiting the vehicle.
His hands are still out.
She is clearly complying with, it seems, with the officer's command.
She's complying. Yes, she's complying. Walking back, making sure that she complies. So they'll get her on the ground, take her into custody. So she's obviously cooperated at this stage. He's still got both arms out, both hands out.
So they have her now. She's in custody now.
Yep.
They want him. They want him, and she's obviously secondary. They want to get him out of that car. He's the one who's the main individual in this particular situation.
He's the principal.
He is the principal. She's secondary. So now they're going to take her into custody. She's complying.
It seems like he's still talking to them.
And what does he have in his hand? Does he have something there in his hand?
A bottle.
It's unknown. It seems to go in and out. Now he's out, both arms, both hands out of the car.
And he's holding something. There could be a can or a bottle or something.
It seems there's something in the right.
Right.
Yes.
The right hand.
In the right hand.
Bottle.
Yeah, it looks like it might be a bottle or a can or something like that. Yeah.
So he's still having the conversation. Fortunately, she's out of the car, so she's now in safe custody of the officers. The situation is they've got to get him out one way or another. And if there's no weapon, then they can rush on the car. But the fact is, he could have a weapon next to the seat.
Right.
They're not going to take that chance. They want to get
him out.
I mean,
they could question the girlfriend, but still,
you don't know if she's telling
exactly.
the truth.
Exactly. So that's
not
exactly comforting. Right.
She's not going to be a
she's not credible.
That they're going to have any credibility. But this will last until he decides voluntarily to exit that car. They're not going to throw tear gas in the car. This is a wait and see at this particular stage.
Well, at
while
this
drama continues.
At this point, the options are really limited. There are no options. So he could just drag this thing out.
Well, he could stay in that car, and this has happened in the past, where they stay in the car, and then they bring the SWAT team out, and they put tear gas in the car if it goes to that extreme. But
It's interesting you should mention that, Dennis, because we've heard word, and of course, you know, a lot of this, you don't know whether what you're hearing is actually what's going to happen, but we've heard word that the SWAT Bearcat might be brought out. What is that? What would it do, and what difference would it make?
Well, what the Bearcat does is they'll block the car with the Bearcat. They have the ability with the Bearcat, with different armament, different weapons, different technology, they can then make sure that the officers are not injured. They have a lot of different tools at their disposal in the Bearcat that the officers in patrol cars don't have. So there's a lot of options available. We had a pursuit not that long ago. In fact, I was broadcasting it on Fox 11, where they did bring the Bearcat out, and they blocked the car. The individual was in the car, and the Bearcat blocked it, and ultimately they got him out of the car. But it's not unusual in a situation like this where they call the SWAT team, and they'll respond, and they respond with the Bearcat, which is that vehicle that they use for normally rescuing individuals, but it has a lot of technology, a lot of equipment that they can deploy, and that's what may happen in this situation if he doesn't want to get out of the car, because these officers are not going to approach him while he's in that car.
That is a big bottle. We just looked at a bigger monitor here in the studio, and whatever we thought was in his hand, it's definitely a big bottle of some sort.
Of some kind of liquid.
Yeah. Looks like a yellowish liquid.
See, it might be beer. It might be a bottle
of beer. It looks that way. Yeah. We can't say with any degree of certainty, but it does look like it could be, Dennis.
Yeah, yeah, and that wouldn't surprise me. Get out of jail, go get a beer, steal a car, have the police chase you, and then now this situation. Now it looks like it's back in the car with this bottle.
His body language is very animated, a bit aggressive in the way he's speaking back.
Well, normally they're not going to speak back. They're going to get out of the car, comply,
right.
The game's over, you know, turn around, put your hands up, and go into custody. This person is dragging this out.
Dragging it out.
And he may be impaired. He may be inebriated.
He may be, but they're going to talk to the girlfriend and find out from her any information. Is there a weapon? What's he doing? What's the situation? They're going to interrogate her as quickly as possible and get whatever information they can. So they want to get him in custody. They want to get him in custody as quickly as possible. The Bearcat may be en route.
The car's moving a little there. Do you see that? Uh-oh.
Yeah, but he's not.
Uh-oh.
Now he's going to go again.
Wait a minute.
The passenger door is open.
The passenger door just closed.
Well, the car lurched forward.
Not very fast.
But see, he's not really in control of that turning around as he is in the seat. There we go. Well, yeah, I think that was just maybe his foot slipped off of something because he's not in a position to drive away, leaning out the car like we see.
And but earlier, we believe we did see him taking some what appeared to be pills.
Yes. He was throwing something in his mouth.
Right.
I saw that. And the helicopter did a great photo. I mean, they were really up to it, and they've gotten great coverage from the air. But as we see right now, it's just a wait and see. And this will continue until the Bearcat arrives or some other device is employed versus the officers running up on the car. They're not going to be doing that. It's just too hazardous, especially with his bizarre behavior right now. So this may continue.
It's just a waiting game.
It is. But then those roads are blocked off. All those units are tied up. Everybody's waiting to see what he's going to do. And if he got out of jail, he's been through jail before, so he knows the system. And he'll just drag us out as long as he can. But the police need to bring it to an end in a peaceful manner as quickly as they can. You see the number of units that they have. They're going to stay with this until this comes to an end.
Well, you know, the thing is, you know, the reports that he was just released from jail, and now it looks like obviously he's going to head back to, in the same direction. When you have nothing to lose, you have nothing to lose.
Well, there's no question. After this particular situation, he's going back to jail. He will definitely get booked on this and whatever other charges.
What's that in his hand? Right hand. He just grabbed something. Is that a weapon?
I can't tell what he's got. He's, what is that?
It looked like there was something else that he just took out.
In his right hand. Something in his right hand.
Right. Aside from the bottle.
Right. Which is in his left hand.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he's, there's something. There's something there.
It's difficult to see.
Yes. But there's something there in addition to the bottle.
Mm-hmm.
But he's still leaning out of the car. The car
is. It looks like it could be a phone. It looks like it's
a
phone, Dennis.
Yeah.
A cell phone?
Maybe.
Looks like it might be. You know, we can't say again with any certainty, right. But it looks like that's what it could be.
Well, see, we're going in for a closer view. But it's hard to tell what it is. But he's obviously not in a hurry to get out of the car.
Not at all.
He'll drag this out as long as he can. And there's no end in sight until he decides to surrender or they come in with other units from law enforcement that will bring that to an end.
And there's nonstop talking with this guy. So it's mm-hmm. not like he's taking a break. It's not like he's saying a few comments, waiting for a response. He's continuing to talk, which, you know, suggests that he may be impaired in some way, and he's not thinking, and he's just blathering.
He's rambling as he sits in the middle of the road with the car. And I don't know if they verified if it's a stolen car or not, but at least the car hasn't been involved in any collisions to this point.
And we are still on PCH for those who are just joining our coverage and wondering where this is.
Now, there's an intersection ahead. Do we know what intersection is ahead of him?
Do we have Vinnie Mack who can join
us? 100 yards.
Boulevard.
Where are we?
Seal Beach Boulevard.
Seal Beach Boulevard.
So PCH,
yeah, they've got it blocked up ahead there.
Okay.
So Seal Beach Boulevard will be blocked continuously. They won't be traveling. And then behind, to the rear, whatever's behind, that's going to be blocked also. So it's a static situation. You don't have other cars. You don't have pedestrians. So it's an isolated situation, which is good for the officers. It gives them that opportunity to do what they need to do. It gives them an opportunity to take him into custody eventually without a lot of interference.
Well, this is definitely impacting many people's commutes.
Well, there's people being inconvenienced, a lot of people being inconvenienced by this. I don't know how much traffic goes up and down PCH, but I'm sure the crossroads,
exactly.
So they're going to lock it down until they get him into custody. And I'm sure they're getting a little frustrated because he's not moving. They've got a canine unit there. The canine unit's obviously useful. Whether they bring that into play, it's kind of hard to do something if he's inside the car. But the canine unit is there. I haven't seen any of the SWAT team people or the Bearcat. They may be en route, but they'll use whatever resources are necessary to get him into custody. They're going to hold this out until he is in custody.
So what are the options aside from just waiting?
That's it.
That's it? That's the best?
He either surrenders gives up, gets out of the car, it's into custody. There'll be a standoff until that point. So with the other equipment that law enforcement has, in particular the rescue vehicle, also known as the Bearcat, utilize that. They have other technology they can employ. They've got the canine, which is good, but the canine's not going to jump inside of a car. So they've got the resources available. It's just going to be a matter of time until he surrenders and gets out of the car voluntarily, or they force him out of that
car. So I was about to say, so if they bring the Bearcat in, if in fact that is what's going on, and that piece of equipment, which is a huge piece of equipment, actually enters onto the scene, how does that change the equation? Do they wait at that point, or could they possibly force him out of the vehicle?
They could force him out with that. They have devices that they could force him out of the car, not non-lethal devices that they can employ to have him exit the car. They've used that in the past. Again, they don't want to approach him and cause hazard to themselves. Again, you don't have to worry about the public because there's no public in that area.
Right.
So this is a unique situation, but it's a safe situation as far as endangering the public. There's no public in danger at this particular time. The only hazard would be for the officers. And these officers have certain equipment in their vehicles, but the SWAT team, the equipment they have, can be employed for this. So
there's something coming up there. There it is. There it is right there.
The Bearcat's coming up.
That's what it appears to be. Yes. I don't know if you can see it, Dennis. It's right there in front of, it's right there in front of the car. It's right in front of the car. It looks like an armored vehicle.
There you go. That's it. There it is. That's the Bearcat. That's exactly what we predict is going to happen. So they've responded out. They've got a lot of options with that. So he's not going to go anyplace with that in front of him. But those officers have a lot of different equipment they can employ. But this, is, again, has been utilized successfully in the past, and I think you'll see how they utilize it again. It's a wonderful tool called a rescue vehicle. And that North Hollywood shootout a number of years ago, where they had to use a Brinks truck, and I was at that scene to rescue people. After that, they started to obtain these vehicles, rescue vehicles.
I covered that live on the air, Dennis. I remember that well. I covered it live on the air, and it was a horrific scene.
It was horrific. And then it's interesting that after that situation, no one died, but there were some officers that passed away after that were involved in that tragedy. That bank robbery on Lancashire Boulevard. I believe it was like Laurel Canyon. I think it was Laurel Canyon.
Yes.
The B of A.
It was the Bank of America there, yes.
B of A. Yeah, I still remember that. And I was at that scene, and those two individuals that were robbing banks with all the weapons that they had, and they were willing to die for the cause, and they both passed away. But a lot of people were injured in that tragedy. We didn't have the rescue vehicles at that time. Now we have these, and most departments have them, and you don't use them every day.
Well,
but when you need them, they're there. They're very, very effective.
And one of the situations I remember with that particular one, since you brought it up, is that the police were outgunned in that situation.
Well, sure they were. That's when the officers went to B&B gun sales to get rifles, because the AK-47s that the suspects had, the officers had shotguns and their pistols, and that was it. And they increased the armament of officers after that. Got the rescue vehicles, the Bearcats, and they've become more sophisticated as time's gone on. But it's a situation where you don't use that Bearcat every day, but when you need it, as you need it now, it comes into use, and very specific use for those situations, and that's what we see happening right now. So this reduces the hazard to the officers, increases the safety for them, and they will get him out there deploying the plan, whether they're going to put tear gas in that car or use something else to force him out of that car. And that Bearcat has the opportunity with the trained officers in there. They're all SWAT team people. They know how to handle this situation.
And so
it looks like the SWAT vehicle is inching closer.
Yes, it does
closer.
Look like it's inched closer. And it certainly is close enough to keep him from being able to maneuver out of the situation that he's in.
They must be confident at this point that whatever it is he has in his hand is not a weapon.
No, it appears that it's hard to tell from the view on the screen, but it doesn't look like a weapon.
Right. It looks like perhaps a cell phone.
But believe me, if they knew for certain he didn't have a weapon, this could have ended a lot earlier. But the fact is that fear of a weapon causes it to increase in caution. definitely increasing caution for the officers. But again, we're in an ideal situation. You're basically in an abandoned area, an isolated field, no cars, no pedestrians, no bicycle riders, nothing. So it's a sterile scene where you can then take the time, use the tools appropriate to take him into custody, since he's obviously not willing to exit the car, like his girlfriend who was taken into custody. He's unwilling to be taken into custody, so they're going to get him into custody against his will, and he'll go back to jail where apparently he started out today.
Just moments ago, as we were speaking, we saw him take another drink from his what appears to be a beer bottle, just killing some time, taking his time, no hurry, no rush. But as you mentioned, it is the ideal situation, if you can call it that, where there are no other people around, no other drivers, no other cars, no other pedestrians. The road is open and blocked off just for this particular incident. So they're just going to take their time.
And you know,
exactly.
Dennis, you've seen enough of these things, and so have we. You know, there have been a few times in situations not exactly identical but very similar situations where there has been a standoff where you had a suspect who was drinking a liquid of some kind and the pursuit ended or the standoff ended because nature called.
Oh, really?
That's happened.
That's happened more than one time.
Yes, it has.
Kind of comical, but it has happened more than one time. Where they have to relieve themselves, shall we say.
Well,
they exit the car, but there's not many places in this particular area to relieve themselves because you got open fields and a highway. There's no place to hide. I mean, he's in a unique location, no place to hide.
No, but an opportunity to have to get out of the car. It looks like he's moving.
Well, he set the bottle down.
And they're still talking.
Oh,
they're
he's opening the door. Opening the door.
He's putting his hands up. It looks like he's about to surrender. At least that's the impression he's giving.
It's about time.
Oh.
I think he may.
Does he?
Well, he doesn't have.
Oh, no, shorts.
He has shorts. He doesn't have pants on.
There we go.
Oh.
Yeah, so there's a slight delay from with the view you're seeing. The view
I
that
see.
I'm seeing.
Yeah. Okay.
A slight delay.
But he has his hands on his head.
Up.
Now he's. I see him getting out of the car.
Right.
And now he had his hands on his head, and then he started waving again. You're not supposed to do that, Dennis.
No,
you're not.
No.
You're supposed to follow direction. But he may be intoxicated a bit, also.
Exactly. That's what
we're
speculating could be the case.
Yeah. So now he's facing the officers.
Facing the
SWAT team behind him. And again, the time's on the side of the officers. They're in no rush. They want to take him into custody, but it's not like they have to open up the freeway. Everything's
static.
It looks
like he's taking his shirt off now.
Well, they want to make sure he doesn't have a weapon. That wouldn't be uncommon to take off the shirt to make sure there's no weapon, that he's not hiding. Again, that creates a whole new environment when they have a fear that the individual has a weapon. And that,
right.
Stated at one time during the situation. So now we see.
And he continues to gesture, gesticulate, and just
yelling.
Have a conversation in a fairly aggressive way.
Yeah. Well, he's not happy.
He's agitated. Mm-hmm. He's definitely agitated.
He's very agitated. But what we see happening
almost
now.
It seems like he doesn't know what to do.
Well, they're telling him what to do.
He seems confused.
You know, walk toward us, turn around, put your hands up. It's pretty
go
simple.
Back, go backwards. There you go.
And he's having trouble walking backwards, which anyone could, but if he's intoxicated, it's going to be even more difficult.
Well, see, whichever way he goes, if he decides to run, the canine's going to jump on him.
Right.
So I don't think he's going to jump over the barrier and take off. He's surrounded. There's no way he's going to escape from here. He's going to hopefully cooperate and put this to an end. So he's walking slowly. They're probably going to get him on the ground, but it's probably going to be a little warm on that cement, on that asphalt. But they don't have him in custody yet.
No.
Keep some hands up. Keep your hands up as you cooperate with the direction of the officers, who are telling him exactly what they want him to do.
He's walking backwards now. He's walking backwards. He's more stumbling backwards.
Well,
but
yeah.
So he's
drinking.
Well, he's definitely been drinking. He definitely appears to be intoxicated.
Right.
I mean, the fact that he's not cooperating. So now he's doing what he's supposed to do,
mm-hmm.
or what they're telling him to do, what they're directing him to do. But there's, you know, he could have something in his pocket or his waistband. Unlikely at this particular juncture, but they want to make sure. They want to make certain that he doesn't have any kind of weapon. And then once that's determined, then they'll put the cuffs on him and away he goes. They'll impound the car, find out from the girlfriend the story, and put this to rest.
You have to assume that he's impaired because, I mean, Dennis, when it gets to this point, they know they are done.
Right.
So for him to continue trying to converse with the officers tells you there's something else going on there.
Well, he knows where he's going. He knows he's going to jail. There's no question in his mind. He's obviously in no hurry to get there. And while
down
he was drinking, it looked like it was beer. So you see the officers have their weapons out to make sure, to make certain, until he's in custody.
And they still have to check that car out since it's so darkly tinted to make sure there isn't
right.
anyone else in there. Is that right?
Exactly. There could be someone hiding in the back seat, and that's happened before.
Mm-hmm.
Unlikely, but they want to verify. And this is a tactical situation where once he's in custody, they'll approach the car. But as you see, the officers who are deployed appropriately, one officer is telling him what to do. Other officers are giving cover. If he were to do anything right now, if he were to take off running, that canine would be on him
so quickly. Yeah, the canine's ready to go.
They're ready to go. Mm-hmm. And that dog is anticipating, but that's why that dog is there, and it's a very useful tool.
There we go. They're approaching him now, and they got him.
They have him.
They have him.
You see the canine's on the top left.
Right.
So he's finally cooperating. Finally giving
now, it's very interesting, Dennis. He's being taken into custody, and now we've seen the Bearcat move in between the cruisers and the car, which is still there.
Mm-hmm.
And now it's backing back.
Well, the Bearcat came. It didn't do anything, but it was there. Probably developing a tactical plan, and in the meantime, he decided, let me get out of the car and finally surrender.
All right.
That,
well,
standoff took a long time.
It did.
While he was parked on that roadway. And
Thanks for your help today.
It's a code 4. Now it's a code 4.
It is a code 4. Dennis Zein, former L.A. City Councilman and former LAPD, thank you so much. We appreciate it.
I'm still a reserve with the LAPD, pushing almost 50 years, so I'm still active.
Well, there you go.
Well, there you go. And so he's still a reserve officer with the LAPD. Dennis Zein, thanks so much
for your expert analysis
and all of the information. Really appreciate it. It's always good to hear from you. And here you have it. This has come to a successful conclusion, given that no one was hurt.
A peaceful conclusion.
A suspect is in custody along with his girlfriend, who we believe was with him willingly.
And he's going back to jail, apparently, because he was released this morning.
And again, it's going to be a while before traffic patterns are able to get back to normal, but at least it's over peacefully.